It is a great day to be at Mother Bethel, and I want to thank everyone here from the Amy Church, from Mother Bethel Church, all of you for letting me play a small part in it. I wrote a biography of Richard Allen called Freedom to Profit. And when you're an academic, you hope that maybe a few people will be on your dissertation committee. So imagine my surprise when I keep getting asked to come to wonderful events like this to talk about Richard Allen and his understanding of freedom and justice for all. Let me step back just a minute because I'm supposed to talk about black churches and justice, which is a huge theme. But where I'm at right now helps me understand the importance of that theme in contemporary, not just historical perspective. I'm at the Library Company of Philadelphia, which is not only the oldest cultural institution in the United States, but was founded by Ben Franklin in 1731 as an institution of learning. And one of our primary collections is the African American Collection, which has about 15,000 documents, images, and other things relating to the African and African American experience in the world. And if you search under terms like the Black Church, you come up with things that talk about justice. If you search for things relating to African-American spirituality, witness, prophecy, you come up against the term justice. So over and over again, in my own institution, on a day-to-day basis, I'm reminded of the intimate connection between the Black Church and justice. And I think that's a really important theme here today. Because Richard Allen founded his church, he founded the denomination, not only to look back, not only to celebrate in the present moment, but to look forward and to say, where will we be in the future if we keep our minds set on justice? I think that's a really powerful theme, not only for your congregation, for the denomination, but for society at large. I used to tell my students when I would teach, history will make dust of you. In 500 years, someone's going to look back at you and laugh. Just like you look back at the founders and their knee bridges and their funky clothing, and someone's going to say, what difference did you make? And here we are 200 years later, after the AME Church was founded, we know the difference Allen and his church made. So let me talk around this theme of social justice and the Black Church by focusing on three different eras in Richard Allen's life. They're also important eras in the life of the Mother Bethel Church and the AME denomination. These span 40 different years from the moment that Allen started this church here in this historic space until the moment that he died. The first era that I want to focus in on is the late 1790s. This is about 5 or 6 years after Mother Bethel was dedicated, consecrated. It's a working operation. And you would think that someone like Allen, a young person on the make with an institution to run, would think only about running that institution, making sure it was successful. Of course, having his mind set on justice made him realize that he had other priorities on his mind. And so in 1799, when George Washington passed away, the hallowed president of the nation, Richard Allen knew what he had to do. He gave a sermon in this church on George Washington's life. He didn't focus in on the things that the rest of the United States was focusing in. The rest of the United States focused in on Washington's service in the Revolutionary War, for his service at the Constitutional Convention, and then his service as President of the United States. And over and over and over again, all of these people said the same thing. Richard Allen, listen, this is the most important thing. At the end of his life, George Washington felt guilty about his practices. He tried to wash his hands and get rid of the stain of that horrible institution. Richard Allen, in his heart of hearts, probably knew that Washington didn't do enough, but he said he did something. And Richard Allen gave a sermon here that he then turned into an essay that he published in newspapers all along the Atlantic seaboard. And he said, we should follow George Washington's example in the future. We should make America a land of justice. And he challenged not only the politicians around the country, the citizenry itself to stand up to Washington's standard. It's a brilliant, brilliant sermon and challenge. And it just shows you that Richard Allen understood what time it was. It was time to talk about justice. And it started here in this church. 7 years later, this church was under siege. It was As many of you know, White Methodists continually challenged Richard Allen's ownership of this church. And matters came to a head in 1807, when various officials said, we're going to tell you what to do, we're going to tell you what preachers you can have here, we're going to tell you that we own this building, and Richard Allen and this congregation got together, and they said, no, you are not. We're going to stand for a different type of justice, the justice of self-determination, respecting every single voice. And they published something that they read out to the Methodist community in general, the African Supplement. The African Supplement stood for not only self-determination of black people, but broad equality across all lines of difference. All voices matter, the African Supplement. But a decade later, as a matter of fact, the White Methodist cited this document as a really important part of the broader Methodist expansion of freedom. And it is that document I will submit to you that leads to the court case a decade later that will solidify the aim of the foundation, create Mother Beth's true independence. Again, start here with Richard Allen and his congregation focusing on different form justice. Final example comes near the end of his life. Allen is aged, he's tired. He's seen so much. Worst of all, he's seen slavery and racial injustice grow in the land of freedom. Now, even if he wanted to do something, the question is, could he? At 70 years of age, like people much younger than him, he could say, I did enough. I started a church. I led a movement. I helped people survive yellow fever. I talked about justice for decades when all was doing it. And he said, the time is not here for me to sit still and go away. And so in this church, in this space, September of 1830, he gathered national activists from churches around the country to talk about black civil rights, then and in the future. What are we going to do? Where are we going to go? What does justice mean, not only now, but for future generations of people? They gathered for 3 days. They talked about everything under the sun. They talked about going to Canada. They talked about staying in the United States and making the Declaration of Independence real in their lives. But the most important thing they did was define justice as a social movement. This is not something that could be defined by one person, one church, one moment. It was something that would require people across the country to gather forces, hold hands, and stand up for justice in their life. Ladies and gentlemen, Richard Allen died the next year. But the spirit lived out in so many different ways. In the 1850s, there was a story circulated through parts of the South that Richard Allen had miraculously been born. He was haunting the slave quarters of Louisiana, Mississippi, all kinds of places. And they asked in Philadelphia, is this true? We thought Richard Allen died. They said, well, his body didn't pass, but his spirit is alive. Ladies and gentlemen, that's why I wrote the book. Because when I started my study, I was trying to understand the evolution of justice, and I couldn't do it by looking at the standard figures we studied in the late 18th century, George Washington, Ben Franklin, John Adams. In many ways, great people, in many ways, fatally flawed people. You have to add Richard Allen and that church to that group.